Thank you, Madame Maria Palazzi. Valerio, this time I took the liberty to start my remarks with a protest. In the name of all the optimists in the world, I came here to protest against the deliberations I heard here. I think they are unfounded and unbased. I can see the paradox is when people are talking rather pessimistically about the future, but when I have a look at history, history is the most optimistic thing in life. And I say, why should I listen to all the stories by people who are all the time worried, and I can see the facts which are obvious. You know, if I look historically, 10,000 years ago, there were in the world not more than 10 million people. Today, in the middle of this century, there will be 10 billion people. Humanity grew 1,000 times in 10,000 years. Not only that, life expectancy went up 2, 3, maybe 4 times. And the health, the food, the dress, everything was improved. And when I look at Europe, which today is very pessimistic, I want to remind my European friends that, you know, until 70 years ago, there were wars in Europe, 2 great wars, the first and the second. The cost of these wars was terrible. The Russians, the Europeans, my God, millions and millions of people. In those 70 years, there is no war. But I want to say something else that people ignore. The war ended in 1945. Since 1955, the average income in Europe went up 15 times. And people say, well, why do we take it so poorly? And I can go and continue some of the figures. You know, China, the new China, was created 49 years ago. They have an old culture, as we do. Israel was created 48 years ago. China is 1 year older. Look at China 49 years ago. Poor, divided, desperate, ignorant, my God. A hopeless land of 1,200,000,000 people. Look at China today. What happened in 49 years? They're almost the second most important economic power. How did it happen? Is it unimportant? Is it justification for any pessimism? The same I can say about India and many other countries. We started a year later than China, and we were like China. Small. We had nothing, you know. We wanted really the Jewish people to come back to Israel and go to work, cultivate our own land. We were very enthusiastic. I myself remember those years. I was a member of a kibbutz. I thought they'll give us land, they'll give us independence, and we shall go. The disappointment was total. We have a very small piece of land, just 1 promille of the Middle East, 1,000th part of the Middle East, nothing. The land was poor. In the north, there were mosquitoes. In the south, there were a desert, stones. And the land itself was a refusing land, very poor. Then we didn't have water either. You know, we have 3 lakes. One lake was so small that we decided to dry it out and have the land. The large lake is called the Dead Sea. It's a sea that was born dead and remained dead to this very day. It's the only sea that doesn't have neither fish nor water. How can you call it a sea? If you want salt, you can find it. We have one river. It's not the Volga. Don't be worried. The Jordan River, which is quite famous. But it's the only river in the world that has more fame than water. If you want quotation from the Bible, go to the Jordan River. If you want to irrigate, it's a loss of time. Don't do it. We didn't have any natural resources, neither oil nor gold. They say in the Middle East there were two sorts of countries, the oily countries and the holy countries. I assure you, we were totally holy. We didn't have a drop of oil. We were alone. We didn't have any partner to our religion, to our language, to our history. Totally alone. And also, we were small. There were 650,000 Jewish people and 50 million Arabs who at that time decided to destroy us. Now the people of the countries that voted for the establishment of Israel declared an embargo against us, so we didn't have rifles to defend ourselves. We looked around, as enthusiastic as we were, and we see we don't have a choice. We cannot make a piece of bread. We cannot have a rifle to our own defense. That's what helped Israel. Namely, since we didn't have any natural resources, we discovered that the greatest natural resource is the human being. We don't know it. But every lady and every man possess treasures of talent, of knowledge. And Israel is not a country that was built by land or resources. It's a land that was built by people. Their initiative, innovation, working hard, defending. You know, since we didn't have anything for agriculture we have had at the time was 95% high-tech, 5% only water and land. And to our great surprise, this artificial agriculture provided us with yields 15 times higher than in any country. We became rich because we had nothing. Now I spoke about China. So we went to the Chinese. I was among the first Israelis that went to China. And I was then foreign minister, and the foreign minister of China received me. He knew that I'm a graduate of an agricultural school. He told me, have a look at the Chinese agriculture. I had a look, I couldn't believe his eyes. So backward. Tell me, you know what? Let us build an Israeli farm of agriculture in China on our account. They agreed. We built. It spread like a fire. It was one of the main reasons why China went up. You know, we didn't send experts. We sent them instead of it seeds. Our seeds of everything are producing many times more than any other seeds. For example, the seeds of wheat, 5 times higher. And to this very day, we are very friends with China. So I look at this large country, China, and this small nothingness, Israel, and we shared the same history. A long, maybe 3,000 or 4,000 years, a history of culture, and 48 and 49 years living finally on science. And they say, why are you so pessimistic? I now will go for a moment to Europe. Europe stopped fighting 70 years ago, in 1945. You know, what is the income of per capita in Europe since then? Since not 45, but 55. It's 15 times higher. Why are we complaining? Even the poorest person has electricity, has flowing water, has better food, better dress, and furthermore, it's just the beginning. Because in addition to everything, it's not that so many people today know how to write and read, but we establish something which is quite sensational, a collective brain. You know, in order to produce a pencil, it took 10,000 workers to do. Today, have some robots that make the pencil without probably any person. And it's going to change greatly. I shall just mention one horizon, and that is, we are at the beginning of a new age of predictability. Namely, we can begin to focus what will happen. When you look at our schools, at the universities, what do they teach? Things that did happen, in my judgment, they are valueless. You know, because there is no experts for things that may happen. There are only experts for things that did happen. And what did happen is old, old-fashioned. People say, well, you have to learn history, otherwise you'll repeat the same mistakes. In my judgment, it's not a very wise remark, because suppose you won't make old mistakes, you'll make new mistakes. Are they better? Are they cheaper? To be oriented on the past is a basic mistake, because with science, the world has changed, is going over from one age to another age. The previous age, which is still continuing in a way, the age of land, you make your living from territory. You wanted more territory? War. You win the war, somebody takes you to get it back. And if you don't want to have a war, you have borders. You have to defend them. So you have to keep an army. And actually the governments of this age were dependent upon defense and security. It cost a lot of money. I think it's also affected our character. I don't believe we have wars because we are bad people. I think we may become bad people because we have wars. Wars permit you to introduce too much discipline, to tell stories, and permits you to have an imaginary leader. What do I mean by imaginary leader? A leader that wants to rule. And that's the political leaders. And they say, I'm great, I'm strong. So people say, are you? Can you bring an end to terror? No. Can you bring an end to the social gap? No. So why do you think you're great? That created another sort of a government, the global companies. The global companies don't have rifles, don't have arms. They are based totally on goodwill. And they are not rulers, they are servants. If they will not demonstrate to their people that their aim is not to have another penny, but to serve the people. They don't have elections, but the clients will disappear. And global companies need clients. They don't have elections. And if they will lose clients, it's the end of the company. And they lose clients if they lose the trust of the people. So even the formula of democracy, and not only democracy, that we are for equal rights to every person, is a little bit strange. You can give equal rights, doesn't mean that people are becoming equal, because we are different. There are people who are more talented, less talented, taller, lower. And now I think more and more people understand that the equal rights is meaningless unless you allow every person to enjoy the equal right to be different. If you don't have the right to be different, there is discrimination. And you can see in those companies people coming from all walks of life. it's a new relationship in the world. And it's going and growing. What is growing is what I call the collective brain. You know, we have today, previously we had people who were analphabetic. Now we have hundreds of thousands of scientists. They are not collective, they are individual. But they have a collective impact. And now we can see the impact of this collective brain. The collective brain is made also of individual brains. Because a boy like the one that built the Facebook, 21, 22, old boy, he didn't have an army, he didn't have a party, he didn't have us, he didn't have an ideology. Look what a revolution he did. And who knew that he will come? He is not alone. There are many like him in Russia, in America, in China, in Europe. And they are going on. And now I want to say, why do I believe that we are nearing the age of predictability? There is no school that teaches you about the future. In my judgment, in the many schools, they are teaching old stuff. There is a tension in the university because the professor who teaches was graduated from the seminar 4 years ago. The students who are listening to him have a smartwatch and they know what happened a moment ago. They are up to date and up tomorrow. So the professors are boring and the teachers are angry and they give them bad encouragement. And you know, we have to change the character of universities. What we do in Israel about it, for example, we encourage the students at the university to become entrepreneurs. Namely, while they are studying, they are developing their own companies. We have 13,000 companies in our universities. 60,000 students who became managers, entrepreneurs, inventors. We have scientists, inventors at the age of 15, 16. Because what do we do to our young people? We don't give them a role in life. Go to the school. And even the mother that loves her baby tremendously, she's half a dictator. All the time she said to the child, how do you go? How do you move? Let him be free. And the children have nothing to do, go to drink vodka or something else. Let them participate in building the future. And you know, there are countries that have many students. When they graduate, they became unemployed. Why? Let them build the high-tech in their own country. When they graduate from the university, they will have already an enterprise of their own. And it answers many countries, and it's not so expensive. And we are talking with those companies, we tell them, gentlemen, if you want to fight terror, become a victim of terror. Don't make a mistake. But we don't suggest you'll take rifles and go and kill terrorists. You don't know how to do it. You can go and try to kill the reasons for terror, which is insult, ignorance, poverty, lack of hope. And it doesn't cost so much. Do it the positive way. Look for the reasons. And that's what brings me to the second point, why I believe that we are near that age, and that is the big data. What is a big data? Take a human being. We have plenty of information about him. Billions of pieces of information. It flows like a river. It's disorganized. And you know, we try to drink it like soup. With a, not with a spoon, but with a fork. You cannot drink water with a fork. Now they organizing the information into a jet. So if I have enough information about your medical biography. And I can know who you are medically. And what is your future? We can tell you what you should do, what you should avoid. And in a very short while, we're going to see a tremendous revolution in medicine. I believe pharmacies will be closed, clinics will be closed, and you will become a member of a company that will tell you what's happening to you and answer your questions. So these two, the big data on one end, and I'm coming to my second complaint about the pessimists. They say, look, the questions remain the same. What we have to change is the answer. It's a great mistake. If you won't change the questions, the answers will be like in the past. What we have to change are the questions, not the answers. To ask, what should we do, and not what happened 100 years ago, 50 years ago. And the minute you have new questions, you'll be surprised to find that you have new answers. I'm talking about Italy. Look, with all the criticism I heard today, Italy is a very able people. And they can produce many things. They have to ask new questions. That's it. They'll ask new questions, they'll find new answers. They'll find people that will answer differently. Now I want to say, well, about that connection in the Middle East, about peace. In the Middle East, there are 400 million people. And in a poor shape, as you know. Discriminating women. If you discriminate women, you have half a nation. With half a nation, you cannot save the whole nation. And the poverty is great, so is the ignorance. But 60% of the people are below the age of 25 or 20. Among them, we estimate there are 60,000 to 50,000 terrorists. They are making all the towers. But there are hundreds of thousands and maybe millions of Arabs, young Arabs, that go to the universities. They graduate from the university, then they don't have where to go to work. What we suggest is to do what we tried, namely to enable the students, the girls and the boys, by the way, 60% of them are feminine, to build their own future. They don't have to look for high-tech. They can build high-tech themselves. And we are asking the companies, telling them, gentlemen, it doesn't cost so much. And you are going to win. Because if you convert a terrible region into a new era, a new clients, you will win. And then if I may make another remark about it, you know, I look at the world with a different eye today. The world, in my judgment, is divided between givers and takers. I think the United States became successful because they were givers. Really, they have the Marshall Plan, which was half of the GNP of America given free to Europe. And they saved Europe after the war. They helped also to participate in the great war that Russia conducted, which was so costly. But if you give, you create something that people don't appreciate. You make friends. Nothing is more paying off than having friends. And if you take, you are creating enemies. Nothing is more costly than enemies. Europe, for example, has many empires. So, and I mean the text will do it. And don't create enemies. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of money. And it's endless. You don't have questions. So that is my double protest. One against the pessimist visa and optimistic history, and the habit to ask old questions instead of dealing with new ones, because the future is more important than the past.